Pat Buckley is an interesting character. What he doesn't realize is that if you become a bishop, you're not supposed to expose sexual abuse, you're supposed to cover it up. And Pat seems to have been exposing things that he shouldn't have. He's come from the Palmarian side of the Christian church. Pat Buckley is a proper Catholic priest. The way that he was made a bishop has been done in a particular way that the Catholic Church doesn't like. This is what the Catholic Church doesn't understand about sexual abuse.
Since all the abuse has started coming out in the last 20 or plus years, the Irish population is gradually turning on the Catholic Church.
In what way?
Criticizing them, not going to church, not giving them any money. If you wear a clerical collar now in the street in Dublin, at least 10 people will shout paedophile at you. Ireland is becoming very anti-clerical, and I'm very happy about it.
And that's what hurts the most when the credit cards get taken away. No more Michelangelo, no more Leonardo, no more Donatello, no more Raphael to tattoo those walls in the Vatican. It's going to be humble pie. And so, one of the most important things for the Catholic Church is money. It's that plastic fantastic. Because the plastic fantastic can cover everything up, money can cover everything up. Just go to a silicone babe that's got out her plastic fantastic to get her new silicone lips and silicone bottom, and you can see how someone can change their presentation and form. Except when the Catholic Church does this, they don't pay for Botox and breast implants, they use it for lawyers. It's the lawyers that give a false interpretation of the church, which is paid through by the plastic fantastic money, in the same way that those go-getting girls get those go-getting breasts to get you to be conned into thinking they're something that they're not. And still, like little children, we still haven't worked it out. So I hear you saying, how do I know the Catholic Church will start apologizing when it runs out of money? Well, the Catholic Church and priests cry for the same reason, when their candy gets taken away from them. When a child has its lollipop taken away from it, and a priest has its, yeah, it's the same thing, isn't it? For the Catholic Church, money is God. They don't understand this themselves, but they need someone like me to explain it to them. When a priest is caught balls deep in a candy shop, in a chocolate bar, they ask everyone for forgiveness. They ask the families to forgive the priests. They ask the mother and father to sign forgiveness contracts where they sort of forgive the priest and then they never speak about it again. And then the church sets up little communities to forgive all the things that it's done wrong. But when a victim comes to sue the church, suddenly forgiveness goes out of the window and lawyers come inside. And so, what you understand, what you see, is that the lawyers are always there behind the scenes. They just need to get the lawyers out when people don't want to forgive. So, a forgiveness is actually the church not having to pay out money. Forgiveness is actually saving money, it's when the church doesn't have to pay any money. So, forgiveness is basically spiritual gooey wooey words which hide paedophiles that are backed by lawyers.
I'm just noticing a little tinge of sadness that I'm feeling for the clergy who had nothing to do with all that.
Andrew makes a really good point about the clergy. Not everyone is at fault, but Buckley comes back with a really good answer.
Yeah, well, I think it's a bit like the situation in Germany after the Second World War. Most of the Germans were Nazis,
Right.
but they didn't speak out. And sometimes they help to cover up.
Yeah.
And I think that priests who weren't part of the abuse itself stayed silent.
And I want to bring your attention to a German pastor that lived during the Second World War, and he was murdered or killed by the Nazis, having himself been a part of the Nazi regime and having himself been responsible for the imprisonment of loads of people. When he died, they found in his pocket a poem, and this is the poem. First they came for the socialists, and I did not speak out because I was not a socialist. Then they came for the trade unionists, and I didn't speak out because I was not a trade unionist. Then they came for the Jews, and I did not speak out because I was not a Jew. Then they came for me, and there was no one there to speak for me. When the clergy have all kept their mouths shut. They have actually done something. It's not that they haven't done anything. They have done something. They've allowed sexual abuse to continue. Not doing something is something. And this is the point which the bishop is trying to get into the people. Thomas Aquinas also said something about this. He also talked about sin, that if you have anger and you don't have the passions of anger when there is just cause, it can be a sin. In other words, what he's saying is that if you see something that's wrong and you don't do anything, or you don't get angry or upset when you see something that's wrong, you are sinning. And the clergy are the main people responsible for the paedophilia. A paedophile can't help what a paedophile does. You can't blame a cat for eating a mouse. You can't blame a paedophile for loving children. But if there are people around that know that this person is ill and that is what he's doing, and they turn a blind eye and they allow the perpetuation of these things to occur, then those silent people are the people to blame. And it's in my personal view that the worst people are the people that kept quiet, are the people that covered up, are the people that said nothing. And in life, we all have these spiritual tests. The priesthood is supposed to be there for your spirituality. And in life, everyday life, you have little tests. When you come up against a situation like this, that is a spiritual test. Not taking the spiritual test on is a failure of that spiritual test. And becoming or relying on the religious rules or your masters or teachers or the authority above you to tell you what to do when it's against God is, again, you failing to understand what spirituality is. And the Christians have a very good way of ramming this down people's throats and ramming it into their brains with dogma and propaganda. So this is a form of brainwashing, and it has to be a form of brainwashing. If you can sit and see children be sexually abused and do nothing, either you're very ill or you've been brainwashed.
People mistakenly think that the Catholic Church has learned its lessons on abuse and the cover-up of abuse, but it's a total lie. One of the things that illustrates that is that every diocese and every bishop and every religious order now have their own safeguarding officer.
This is what makes me laugh. The safeguarding people aren't there. The safeguarding officer isn't there to protect the children. The safeguarding officer is there to protect the church. So going back to Brass Eye, where it's sort of a paedophile disguised as a school,
we're after your help too. Security footage of a paedophile disguised as a school. He's been getting away with it in Sheffield for 12 years. Do you know him? Have you seen him? Please call.
It's a Catholic Church protection officer disguised as a child protection officer. And you can sort of almost imagine, you know, ringing the school and sort of saying, you know, so-and-so is being abused, and the child protection officer saying,
it wasn't me.
I even had her in the shower.
It wasn't me.
She even told me on camera.
Wasn't me.
She saw the marks on my shoulder.
Wasn't me.
Heard the words that I told her.
Wasn't me.
He didn't do it. No, he didn't do it. And the officer is, of course, being employed by the church. And the church, you know, if you're employed by someone, you don't want to lose your job. Yeah. So these people aren't there to safeguard children. These people are there to manage the abuse problem from getting too big. And so the first thing they do is talk about forgiveness, then they'll meet the parents, and then when it comes to suing, then what they'll do is they'll try to protect the school. The child protection officers employed by the schools are not there for the children. They're there to protect the business, because people just need to get their brain around the fact the Catholic Church is a business, it's an enterprise, it's got a bank. You know, since when did a spirituality have a bank? You know, Jesus didn't have a bank, you know, God didn't have a bank, Holy Spirit doesn't have a bank, Virgin Mary doesn't have a bank. Yeah, the only group of people that have a bank that aren't a business are men, and it's called a sperm bank.
The priests of the present are predominantly homosexual. Now, in Ireland, for instance...
When you say they're homosexual, are you saying that they're out, gay men?
No, they're active, but not out.
It's like a cult of closeted gay men. I mean, monasteries and the Vatican.
Yeah.
Is that a fair... Is that an oversimplification, or...?
Especially nowadays.
You've got a group of men whose sexual persuasion for many thousands or hundreds of years has been attacked these gay people, or gay people in general, like Oscar Wilde, they've been put into prison, they've been destroyed, reputations destroyed, and we as the public have lost. I mean, losing Oscar Wilde, the importance of being earnest, Dorian Gray, we by putting him into prison, we destroyed a large part of English writing. What do you think is going to happen if you get this band of men, this band of brothers, and you say, right, you people are dirty, disgusting, you're against God, you're against this, you're against that, we're going to kill you, we're going to cut you up, we're going to banish you. What these guys have done is they've gone, right, we need to survive. So where are they going? Well, they're going into the church and they're going into the monasteries. And what's happening is that they can't come out, they've got to live a lie, and it's turning into a perversion. A lot of these people are gay, they need to come out, and because of the suppression, because you've got to think that sexual energy is energy. If you stop water, water always finds another way to come out. And if you completely stop something like water from moving, it will burst, it will destroy something because the pressure will build up, and sexual energy isn't any different. So if you tell someone that their energy is dirty and what they're doing is dirty, and you ban them and exile them to a place, there's going to be a resentment that's built up against society. And so what's happened is you've got these hiding places where people are shunned by society or feel guilty or told that they're bad, and then they can go to those places and hide. And what they've done is they've managed to get the society to love them again. So what the society would have judged them to be had they been outside the monastery, they then become something which is loved when it's inside the monastery. And the people, I suppose the monks, they can get their revenge back. They can get money off these people, and they can, and the people, the society who hate them, pay for a comfortable life in the past for them to have carried out their lives. So in effect, the monastery is sort of like a self-imposed prison in the past, where the public pay the monks and monasteries money to keep these homosexuals inside the monastery because those people feel that they can't go anywhere else.
No later than yesterday on my blog, I said to such a priest who had had a bad time from his archbishop, why didn't you tell him to fuck off? And his reply was, because he pays my wages.
Here is a fantastic example of a priest who is worried about losing his job instead of doing the right thing. You know, when you're a Catholic or a Christian, that's the whole point. You're supposed to do the right thing when you're faced with challenges. That's what Joan of Arc was about. That's what Jesus was about. Aren't those the type of things that they're supposed to be trying to download into you, your guys' brains in the monastery? Aren't they supposed to try to make you guys into martyrs, to die for the right thing? Yet you've got like these young little priests that will bend towards whatever the archbishop wants because they're scared of losing their job. I'm not going to say anything that, you know, this priest is doing bad to this child because I'm scared I'm going to have my credit card taken away. And you can see how the control in the church is starting to work like a web. Yeah, the church has control over your life. You don't have any independence. You've given up your independence. You've given up your money. And also the other thing is you don't have any skills. If you go from school straight into the monastery, what skill do you have? Or you go from university into the monastery, you might have a degree, but you've got very little life experience. So if you want to go outside the monastery, where are you going to start again? So you're sort of at a real loss. You're sort of in a very vulnerable situation. And then if the archbishop is coming along, and remember the archbishops and the people of power, the clergy of power, they're there to protect the church. They're not there to protect the teachings of the church. They're there to protect the church because the church is a business. If you want anyone to protect the teachings of the church, then you need to listen or look for someone that doesn't have any affiliation with an organization which wishes to cover up sexual abuse, which is completely against the teachings of the church. And as I said before in this video, the teachings of the church go out of the door when the lawyers come in. Jesus goes out, the lawyers come in. For the church, Jesus and the lawyers are interchangeable entities that they choose whenever it suits them. And so you've got these archbishops and these very powerful people in a hierarchical position which are controlling the other people through money and putting fear into people that if you do not abide by the general narrative, then we will punish you.
You see, one of the big things, I don't know whether you've ever thought about this, is priests in the past and the church in the past, they didn't think of abuse as a crime. They thought of it as a sin.
the Catholic Church doesn't really have a lot of different descriptions for different types of sexual sin. So for instance, let's say you've got groping, touching, penetration, kissing, fondling, exposing yourself, cheating, being gay, having alternate sexualities. The Catholic Church just has sort of one united thing that it puts, well, basket for all of them, and it's just called sexual sin. So if you go as a priest and have sex with an adult, then you've committed a sin. And if you go and rape a child, you've committed a sin. And the two sins are sort of seen as the same thing. I think it's only until quite recently that there has been some sort of defining on the different types of sin. And it's got something to do with canon law, and I can't remember what it is. And that's one of the issues. So when the Catholic Church goes, oh, okay, yeah, he's been raped, has he? Oh God, that's terrible. 50 times he's been raped, has he? Poor child. You know, they're sort of thinking that it's like a legitimate relationship with a grown woman.
I get hate mail every single day of my life.
That's awful.
When I turn on my blog in the morning,
yeah,
I get at least 10 messages of absolute hate.
Do you know who they're from?
Generally, I suspect they're from priests.
And what do they say?
Well, do you know I have HIV? Did you read that?
No, I didn't.
But priests call me every night an AIDS-ridden fucker.
That's so hateful.
So let me get this right. Here's a bloke who's a bishop that's uncovering crimes, who's exposing sexual abuse, and the people that are inside the system that are doing that are calling him and calling him dirty words and nasty things. And here we can see the people that we're supposed to be following in the society, the priests, they're the problem. If you've got priests which are trying to stop other priests from exposing things which are bad in order to protect children, because all the priests are interested in doing is trying to protect an institution, and that institution has got absolutely nothing to do with God or Christianity or Jesus. Because if you've got something to do with something, it's not in name, it's in behavior. You can't judge everything by words. You can't judge everything by suits. You can't judge everything by titles. You can't judge everything by a facade. And that's where Pat Buckley seems to be a bit different. He's actually putting his head on the line. He's actually saying things that no one wants him to say. He's saying things that priests should be saying. And what's happening is that whenever you stick your head out to do the right thing, whenever you come up against something like sexual abuse, whenever you come up against something which is trying to destroy the fabric of society and control the fabric of society through sexual abuse, you're going to get hate. But you don't expect it to be from the priests. And here we have a very, very, very important example of how the Catholic Church manages itself and what type of people are in the Catholic Church that you go to and pray, believe in, and allow bits of bread to be put in your mouth by them. Quite frankly, I wouldn't let a priest put anything in my mouth. If you want to listen to the full podcast, you can go to the links below, and you can go to Podbean, and you can listen to everything from Andrew Taylor's Podbean website.